You're listening to the audio production of Operation Happy, a World War II story of courage, resilience, and an unbreakable bond by Jenni L. Walsh, published by Zondervan, and read by Gail Shalan and Brian Holden. For dog lovers everywhere, don't worry, Happy is going to be okay.
Part 1. Island Girl.
Chapter 1.
Wish List. Christmas 1938. A dog is at the top of my wish list. I unwrap number 3, a Monopoly board game. Then I pluck number 5 from under the Christmas tree, a Shirley Temple doll. And number 2, a new Nancy Drew book. But number 1 is still very much missing. Mom asks my older sister,
"Are you happy, Peggy?"
"Very," Peggy says, as she should be. She got her number 1, a makeup set.
"And how about you, Jody?"
I nod quickly, like the good soldier I am. I'm a Marine, inducted at birth because of Dad being a commanding officer. And I'm not unhappy. I got a lot of things checked off my wish list. But a dog? I've been aching for a dog. Big and shaggy. I want that dog to take up so much room on my bed, there will barely be a sliver left for me. And when that bed becomes a bed in a new house, and then a different bed after that, going to sleep will always feel the same after I close my eyes because he will be there. Or she. I don't care what my dog is, only that I get one. Dad stands from his armchair and quietly slips from the room. I gather the wrapping paper strewn about our living room. Mom's eyes flick to the doorway. Mine do too. Dad appears. In his hand is a leash. That leash stretches behind him. Attached to that leash is something big and fluffy with a red bow the exact same shade as Dad's robe. I gasp. Peggy squeals. I give her a quick glare. She didn't put a dog on her list.
"His name is Happy,"
Dad says. "Yeah, it is. This dog looks nothing short of happy, his tail wagging so hard I'm surprised his feet stay on the ground." I jump to a stand so fast my glasses nearly fall off my face.
"Careful now,"
Dad says.
"Happy was a sentry dog for the base, but his eyesight's going. He's been more or less a mascot for some time now. Approach him slowly so he can see the shape of you."
I do, saying, "Hello, Happy. My name's Jody." And by the time I reach him, he's taking steps toward me, too. And I swear, that dog is smiling like no dog I've ever seen before.
Chapter 2. Back on Duty. This is her, his new human. Happy is officially back on duty. As her hand sinks into his shaggy fur, he sits, solid like a rock, easier for her to pet. Jody coos, "What a good boy." He's heard that before. Happy loves hearing that from his humans, although it took some time to understand how they talked. Humans use a lot of words, confusing ones too. Cattywampus has nothing to do with cats, he doesn't think. Then there's looky-loo. Happy used his back paw to scratch his head the first time he heard that one. Malarkey is another. It sounds like an ingredient in his dog food. But when his old handler, Gordon, once said, "Now that's a bunch of malarkey," there weren't any pellets to eat in sight. But the simpler words, the everyday words, he learned lickety-split. That means fast. While he worked as a guard dog, protecting his humans and patrolling the base. When Gordon said, "Happy, sit," he sat. "Happy, heel," he trotted right beside Gordon's feet. "Happy, stay," he remained behind. "Happy, move in," he began to inch closer to their target. "Happy, get him," he lunged and bit down hard and growled to show he meant business. "Happy, out," he released his bite. "Happy, hup." That meant jump, but he never knew how high. So he jumped the highest he could every single time. Happy took his job very seriously. When the sun went down and his collar went on, it was like a light switch flicked up inside of him too. His muscles were loose, his senses were keen. Every unique smell, sound, movement, he was on it. Nothing got past him. He once single-bitedly stopped an intruder from getting on the base. Happy latched on tight, yanking and pinning the intruder to the ground until Gordon took over. But when the sun came up and his collar came off, his tongue promptly lolled to the side and he heard Gordon say, "It's darn near impossible not to look at you and smile. You make me happy, buddy. Go get some rest. You earned it." And that was when he knew he'd really done his job. The thing was, as time went on, Happy's job got harder. His eyes started working less and less for him until he saw little more than shapes. But he didn't rely on his eyesight much anyway. Happy mostly used his eyes to detect movement. To really do his job, he had his sniffer, which was an excellent one that always steered him straight. Maybe he'd misjudged a step or two or a whole flight of stairs, but he shook it off, slobber flying. Problem was, his humans worried about him and his eyes. "He could get himself hurt," they said in whispers. "Or us." He'd never let such a thing happen. Never. Happy grinned extra for his humans, letting them know it. But their faces were hard to read, blurry and fuzzy. One day, Happy was on his back, getting belly rubs, when Gordon said, "We've been together a long time, boy. I'm going to miss you. I'm going to miss you a lot." Happy rolled over. He cocked his head. I know, Gordon said. "It'll be a change for us both." Happy tilted his head to the other side. Gordon was sitting, legs crossed, with his knees pointing out, but his shape wasn't as straight as it normally was. He was more slumped. Sad? "Your job here is done, boy." His job was done? Happy Army crawled closer, whimpering softly, nudging with his wet nose. "It's nothing you did wrong, boy. It's simply time. For me, too. I'm retiring. No more work for either of us." No more work? No more doing his job? Keeping his humans safe? Making people happy? Happy had thought, no, that couldn't be right. Gordon cupped Happy's cheek, scratching behind his ear. Happy leaned into it. "I'm going to spend time with my grandkids. Where you're going, I hear you'll have your own kid. It'll be an important job, Happy. You'll have a new little girl to make happy." And that little girl is right in front of him. It feels like an eternity has passed between saying goodbye to Gordon and hello to Jody, but he's here now, and he has a job to do.
Chapter 3. Best of. Happy claimed me, and I claimed him. Now we're inseparable. Two peas in a pod, compadres. Where I go, he goes. And since he joined our family 2 years ago, we've lived in quite a few places and shared quite a few beds. Today, we're aboard the SS Lurline, on our way to yet another new home. Happy's fluffy fur catches the sea breeze. I run a hand down his back. When I stop, he nudges me for more loving. "Don't worry, boy. You're done being below deck. We'll be back on land before you can say collywobbles." His forehead wrinkles. I laugh, squeezing his head against my leg. It's good to have him with me again. We've been on the steamship for nearly 6 days, each turn of the engine bringing us closer to our new home in Hawaii. For those almost 6 days, poor Happy was boarded on a lower deck.
"How long have you had him?"
a crew member said to me during one of my many visits to the kennels. I said proudly, 2 years. He was fully grown when we adopted him. We've been all over together."
"Ah, a fellow traveler."
He rolled up his sleeve, revealing two tattoos, a turtle and a bird.
"This one here," he said, tapping the shell, "commemorates how I've crossed the equator. The swallow means I've sailed more than 5,000 miles. Got that one ages ago. This trip alone gets you halfway there. Almost time for your own ink.
He winked, to which I snorted. Mom would rub a tattoo clear off my body.
Anyway, he finished. Sure is a big dog for such a little girl.
Little? I already tower over Mom, almost Peggy, too. I twisted my lips, but politely answered. He's a German Shepherd Collie Husky mix. A mutt. Like me. I'm a Washington, D.C., Bremerton, Quantico, Long Beach, North Island, Yerba Buena Island mix. I certainly have earned my own bird tattoo. Most recently, we lived on North Island in San Diego. Dad was supposed to be stationed there for 2 years, but before we even hit 2 months, a telegram arrived out of the blue. You are ordered to report to the United States Naval Air Station, Ford Island, Pearl Harbor, assuming command of the Marine Barracks, October 16, 1940. Reservations have been made for your family to embark on the SS Lurline, October 10, 1940. I still can't shake Mom's reaction to this sudden transfer. As a military family, we move a lot. Together. Always together. The Marines have a saying, Semper Fi. It means always faithful. But Mom didn't want to go. The idea of her not coming was unthinkable. In the Marines, there are teams with 3 members and a leader. We're Team Zuber. Dad, Mom, Peggy, and me. Happy's a bonus. Just knowing I'm part of our team always helps me settle in at each new place we go. So does my best of list. The 10 things I like about my new home. The top of each and every list is identical. Number 1, Happy takes up half the bed. But I'm nervous about my best of list for Ford Island. I overheard Mom tell Dad that she had a bad dream, and that this island was more than an island. She said it was the island, whatever that means. Maybe it has something to do with the war? It's been going on in Europe for about a year, but the war doesn't involve Dad. Or the United States in general, so we haven't paid much mind to what's happening over there. Here we go, Happy, I say, forcing cheer into my voice. You're number 1, of course, but let's see what else will go on my best of list here. I survey the approaching island of Honolulu. With Happy not having the best vision, I'm his eyes. There's a huge mountain. It's right along the water, I tell him. The bluest water we've seen yet. Happy turns his head up toward me, showing me an underbite of white teeth, like he's grinning. Sea mist coats my glasses. I clean them on the hem of my dress. There's another mountain, too. This one looks like the dorsal fin of a fish. We're getting really close now, and so far, I'm not seeing what's made Mom so nervous about coming here. Still, I grip the railing tighter than necessary. My charm bracelet clangs against the metal. Mom, putting on a fake smile, let Peggy and me choose something from the gift shop. I chose a bracelet with 3 charms, a surfboard, a palm tree, and a blue and green tropical fish. Number 2, I live somewhere with tropical fish. Happy twitches his nose. New scents, huh? Unfamiliar ones carry on the breeze. Somehow, both sweet and spicy. Number 3, it smells really nice here. I won't put this next one on the list yet, not until we experience it for ourselves, but Hawaii has some great surfing, hence the surfboard charm. One day, I'll get you on a board, I tell Happy. Would you like that, boy? His tail wags. I can see him on the board, tongue hanging out, riding a wave. I bet his 4 legs would help with balance. I chuckle to myself, just thinking about it. Men in canoes paddle toward us, cheering the ship's arrival. Peggy is suddenly beside us. Where are Mom and Dad? I ask her. She pulls her long, curly hair into a low ponytail. Finishing a bridge game. Not surprising. They're addicted to the card game, even winning the shipwide tournament. Oh, look! Peggy says, Aloha Tower. It's tall, thin, and white. I know its name, I pretend. You don't have to tell me. She shrugs. Then the docks of Honolulu come into view. There are musicians, Happy! Dancers, too! Within seconds, Happy's ears perk to the gentle and soothing music. I sway on my feet. On the dock, the dancers in their grass skirts move their hips. Peggy shouts out, "Aloha!"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.